Look at this cute little dinosaur. Where did it come from? Just because we've never seen a real-life dinosaur with a little heart floating above its head, does that mean it never existed? In all seriousness, the planet we inhabit, better known as Earth, has likely been around for something like 4.543 billion years. That's a lot of years. Chordates, you know, a classification that includes fish, amphibians, reptiles, birds, and mammals, has only been around for 500 million or so. That's only 11% of the Earth's time. Only 11%? This fact alone has just boggled my mind. Scientists have been postulating and hypothesizing about how the first life came to exist. I mean, when you think about it, it's a complete mind bend. So what do you think? Did life on planet Earth begin in a volcano or due to a bolt of lightning? Did faraway aliens bring life to Earth, saving it from the doom of another planet? Are we aliens? So many questions. Let's dive in. This is topic 1.5, the origin of cells. The essential idea here is that there is an unbroken chain of life from the first cells on Earth to all cells in organisms alive today. One of the common areas of thought is that the first cells must have arisen from non-living material. I know. It doesn't really make sense on the surface, but hear me out. This theory is called abiogenesis, genesis being the beginning, and abio means non-living. So what exactly is this theory of life from non-living material? Well, this process is theorized to occur over four stages. First, there was non-living synthesis of simple organic molecules from primordial inorganic molecules. These simple organic molecules became assembled into more complex polymers. Certain polymers formed the capacity to self-replicate, which this enabled inheritance. Lastly, these molecules became packaged into membranes with an internal chemistry different from their surroundings, and these are called protobions. Well, Mr. O, so whatever gave rise to this theory? Well, this theory has in fact been tested, and there is supporting evidence for this. Stanley Miller and Harold Urey were two scientists that in 1953 conducted an experiment to test this. Essentially, Miller and Urey concocted a set of test tubes and flasks that were a closed system, completely consisting of different gases and conditions found on Earth. As you look at the picture on the right, you can see the general setup. I will talk you through the process. First, water was boiled to vapor to reflect what is thought to be Earth's original conditions. This gassy water vapor combines with ammonia, methane, and hydrogen gases in the experimental hot atmosphere. Then, the gassy mixture was exposed to an electrical discharge to simulate lightning. After this, the mixture was cooled and turned into liquid water again. Over time, the condensed mixture was analyzed and found to contain traces of simple organic molecules. Now that your mind is blown that this could even happen, here were the conclusions on the Miller-Urey experiment. First, Miller and Urey concluded that organic molecules, including amino acids, can form from inorganic molecules. Second, they concluded that because of their experiment, that on prebiotic Earth, that organic molecules would be able to form. While they sadly did not spontaneously generate any dinosaurs, that event occurred years later and was featured in the hit movie Jurassic Park. Just kidding on the third part. Even after Miller and Urey's experiments, scientists that have reproduced it have been able to generate lipids and RNA nucleotides. But here's the major catch. Earth as we know it today was not Earth that existed 4 billion years ago. Conditions were different, and on Earth today, we really don't have those conditions. But scientists have postulated that on prebiotic Earth, that places with really extreme conditions like volcanoes, hydrothermal vents, shorelines with fluctuating wet and dry conditions, as well as comets and vehicles carrying some life form that ended up here from somewhere. The fact is, scientists don't really know, as most of the primitive Earth has been recycled and melted back via tectonic plate action. But truly, abiogenesis is getting life from non-living. I mean, what I'm trying to say is that the chemical processes that combined to the initial formation of biological life required specific conditions to proceed, and these do not commonly exist on Earth, and so living cells cannot just arise independently via abiogenesis. So, biogenesis occurs, which is cells being formed from pre-existing cells. Robert Virchow proposed this in his research. So how did he know? Well, humans have observed cells coming from other cells through binary fission, mitosis, and meiosis, but never have we observed spontaneous generation on Earth. The evidence that we have is that spontaneous generation does not occur on Earth in its current state of being. So this theory is called biogenesis, meaning that life is formed by the division of pre-existing cells. So let's drop some evidence down here and talk about how we know about life on Earth today. The first thing is the traceability of life, particularly human. You know, back to the original egg sperm fertilization, and one zygote. Additionally, while we do not have the first life forms on Earth, we do have LUCA. What's LUCA? Who's LUCA? Is it a dinosaur? Well, LUCA stands for the Last Universal Common Ancestor, and existed 3.5 to 3.8 billion years ago. Think topic 5 and cladograms, where the three domains branch off from one common ancestor. LUCA is that ancestor that gave rise to the three domains of eubacteria, archaebacteria, and eukarya. Still one problem though, we just don't know how the first cells got here. But there must have been a first cell that arose from non-living material. One experiment that was pretty rad related to biogenesis is via the French scientist Louis Pasteur. He is known to have created the law of biogenesis. He was the first scientist that demonstrated that emergent bacterial growth in nutrient broths was due to contamination by pre-existing cells. Pasteur wanted to see if the air had some ability to assist in the creation of living organisms, that it had a vital force. He concluded that it did not, but let's discuss his methods and process because it is important. You all look at the image while I talk the talk. First, broths were stored in vessels that contained long tubing, called swan neck ducts, that did not allow external dust particles to pass. The broths were boiled to kill any microorganisms present in the growth medium, and this is called sterilization. You know, he didn't want contamination. He purposefully broke some of the flasks and kept some intact. Growth only occurred in the broth if the flask was broken open, exposing the contents to contaminants from the outside. From this, Pasteur concluded that emergent bacterial growth came from external contaminants and did not spontaneously occur. Therefore, that air did not contain a vital force that creates life, and that life comes from life. While Pasteur really wanted to set the record straight on spontaneous generation, he probably did until Miller and Urey came along. A side note here, Pasteur is a scientist also credited for the pasteurization technique that we use for many consumable goods, for example, something like milk. The other thing we need to discuss here is how eukaryotic cells arose. You know, eukaryotic cells are membrane-bound and have membrane-bound organelles. Some of these organelles may have just ended up inside of us and became incorporated into the cells. The endosymbiotic theory explains the existence of several organelles of eukaryotes. The theory states that the organelles, specifically mitochondria and chloroplasts, originated as symbioses between separate single-celled organisms. An endosymbiont is a cell that lives in another cell with mutual benefit. Eukaryotic cells are believed to have evolved from early prokaryotes that were engulfed by phagocytosis. The engulfed prokaryotic cell remained undigested as it contributed new functionality to the engulfing cell. For example, photosynthesis. Over generations, the engulfed cell lost some of its independent utility and became a supplemental organelle. Mr. O, stop it with the crazy talk again. Give me the evidence. All right, so for both chloroplasts and mitochondria, they have a number of similarities in common with prokaryotic cells. In addition to a similar size and shape, they have 70S ribosomes, circular naked DNA, gene sequences, movement, binary fission, and they're susceptible to antibiotics, and they have a double membrane. You can see in the image at the bottom right how the phagocytosis could have occurred and incorporated a cyanobacteria that gave rise to a chloroplast or an aerobic bacteria that gave rise to a mitochondria. If you like documentaries and David Attenborough is one of your heroes like he is mine, then you should check out First Life. Additionally, because most organisms in Earth's history have gone extinct, and some organisms we do not know about, we do not officially know if there was ever a Tacosaurus. I mean, maybe there was, and it had the crunchiest shell filled with only the most satisfying ingredients. That's our dive into the origin of cells. Stay woke to the IB Bio, and hopefully no non-living objects start moving in front of you. As always, it's really important to give credit where it's due. While the presentation script and video are solely of my own creation, many of the images and information contained in the presentation are not. So shoutouts to the following. Most of the images and video clips come from IB Bio Ninja and some of the information used. Other images and info come from Biology for Life, Bionology, iBiology, and a few other places too. Lastly, some information was gleaned from the Cambridge edition of the IB Biology text, as the intended purpose of this presentation is to keep you woke with yet another resource tool to enhance your learning for the IB Biology curriculum. And this should be used under a Creative Commons Attribution License. Peace out.